first day without any organizers, right? So let's see how that goes. I would now first like to recap a bit what we did last lecture, because it was Tuesday, so it's more than one day ago. And what we looked at back then was the conservative dynamics of compact bodies, right? So the motion of two black holes or neutron stars around each other, but restricted to the case where basically you have energy and angular momentum conservation and nothing much happens. The two stay on their orbits. Maybe there's some perihelion precession at most, and if they would be on circular orbits, then nothing would happen, right? The system would not evolve. But in reality, of course, there's angular and energy and angular momentum loss due to the gravitational wave emission, and that's what we want to add today. But first, let's briefly recap what we found. So we found that we can construct a Hamiltonian for the binary system. And from the Hamiltonian, we can get equations of motion. And that Hamiltonian was obtained through some energy map that was taking us from an effective Hamiltonian to the real Hamiltonian. And that effective Hamiltonian was constructed by taking a test body moving in a black hole spacetime. And then we were deforming that spacetime a little bit, and also the mass shell constraint that is used to get the effective Hamiltonian. And what we've seen then is that this effective metric, which is a metric in which this test body moves and from which we get the effective Hamiltonian, that was basically just the Schwarzschild metric at 1 PN order of accuracy. So that is to say, if we just use the Schwarzschild metric and a test body in that metric, we plug that into the energy map, then basically we get a Hamiltonian that automatically is accurate to the first post-Newtonian level of approximation. So that's a very nice way then to resum, so to say, the post-Newtonian dynamics. And if you continue then, you see that you need some deformation in the symmetric mass ratio. At the second post-Newtonian level. So eta was basically mu divided by the total mass, so it's m1, m2 divided by m1 plus m2 squared. Right? So we have to take the Schwarzschild metric and introduce some small deformations which depend on this mass ratio. And this were just really just two terms that we had to put there. And then we would get a dynamics that would be accurate to second post-Newtonian level even. So the Hamiltonian, as it comes out from post-Newtonian calculations, is quite huge. And then finally, at the third post-Newtonian and the fourth post-Newtonian level, so that's basically state of the art. The fifth order is not known yet. You get also, well, you also have a deformed effective metric that is somehow deformed. But you also have mass shell, the mass shell constraint of the effective particle. So basically, the effective body is not moving on a geodesic anymore. One nice, so that's, this means basically it's non-geodesic motion. But it's still, in some sense, geometric theory, because you can also describe that or understand it as a so-called Finsler geometry. I will not go of what that means, but just to mention that this can still be described in a geometric way. It's just that you have a geometry which does not just depend on a kind of metric that's independent of momenta. Okay. Good. So that's that. What is also important is that this is not yet enough, because the post-Newtonian approximation only a weak field and slow motion approximation, and why we somehow combined it with the test body motion and somehow incorporated a bit of strong field knowledge, it's not guaranteed that this is working very well or very accurately when you compare it to numerical relativity simulations. So what is also done in practice then is one does a further resummation. Whoop, there is. Of these effective one body potentials. So the expressions that I showed you the last time, they were still just polynomials. They were Taylor expansions in the post-Newtonian counting, basically. What is done in practice is that you also resum them in some way, and there are different schools, so to say, which do it in different ways. One way is basically to write it, roughly speaking, as a rational function, or do a so-called Padé resummation. And another way is to wrap them in some way into a logarithm function. But then in the end, what you also do is you introduce some parameters which correspond to the unknown 5pn and 6pn corrections, which you don't know, and you calibrate them to numerical relativity. Okay. Okay, I will come back to this today, later on. So, just to recap, you do a little bit more to these potentials. You don't just keep them in the way that I've shown you last time on the blackboard, but you rewrite them somehow as a rational function eventually, or with some logarithm functions, plus you put some additional parameters which correspond to PN orders that you don't know yet. And these you calibrate to numerical relativity in the end. But there are more things that have to be calibrated, so I'll come back to that later on. But now, so this is just conservative dynamics, no gravitational waves yet, and no radiation reaction, no dissipation. Now, of course, if we want to have an inspiraling binary which moves closer together over time, we have to add that. So now let's see how we can add radiation reaction to what we have so far, which is just conservative dynamics. Okay, and what we do is, well, I mean, it's possible, but not so nice to maybe construct a Hamiltonian which has dissipative forces or radiation reaction forces. That is in principle possible, but Hamiltonians are really most convenient when they just describe a conservative dynamics. So what we do is a bit more ad hoc here. We take the Hamilton's equations of motion, and then by hand, basically, we are putting in forces which correspond to the radiation reaction forces. That's what we do here. But again, it is conceivable also to write down a Hamiltonian which describes dissipative forces. It's just, it's also not so necessary here, because in the end, what we want are the equations of motion. Okay, so what we do is we add radiation reaction forces to the equations of motion. And here I mean Hamilton's equations coming from that Hamiltonian here, from the real two-body Hamiltonian. Force basically means we look at the P dot equations of motion, at the change of the momentum. This is the force, right? So let's write down Hamilton's equations. We have R dot is dH by dPr, and PR dot radial momentum time derivative minus Hamiltonian derivative with respect to the radial coordinate. Then the similar equations for phi dot, which is omega, the angular frequency of the binary motion. That's dH by dL, the orbital angular momentum, right? So the notation was that P phi is L, is the orbital angular momentum. And here we have L dot equal to minus dH by d phi. So that's just Hamilton's equations for that Hamiltonian. And now we add these forces here. And now the question is, how do we get them consistently in some way? Also remember that that thing here is zero, basically due to spherical symmetry of the gravitational interaction. So we have usually when this term is not there, we have angular momentum conservation. Now, when we add radiation reaction forces, that's not true anymore. So that's good. That's what we want, right? So we see already that we have an angular momentum angular momentum loss. But we expect that we not just have an angular momentum loss now after adding these extra forces, but we also should have an energy loss. Yeah? I think so, yeah. Yeah, right. Because the curve metric is also independent of phi, right? Yes. That's probably given by different signs of L then, I guess. Yeah. Yeah. So, I mean, for, yeah, I think that's what it is. Yeah. So, for if that would be a black hole, then this would probably also not be the orbital angular momentum, but maybe just a component in the z direction or something, right? Because here we have set theta equal to pi half. So it's in the orbital plane. And if you don't do that, the Hamiltonian gets more complicated anyway. Yeah, but that's a whole another story of how to add spin effects and rotation of the black holes. Yeah, but also very interesting. Good. Are there more questions so far? No? So then, let's look at the energy loss. So the energy loss, we can compute that by dotting E, basically, and the energy is the Hamiltonian. So we compute that. And you've probably seen something like that in the classical mechanics course. So what you do is you apply product rule. So not product rule. How's the rule called? Where you derive the dependencies, right? You know. So you do that, and then with all the other variables like PR, L, and phi. So that's the phi term, then let's do the PR term. And the L term. Like this. And normally, usually when you now plug in Hamilton's equations, if you use them here for these derivatives, you get zero, so energy would be conserved. But now we have these additional forces, so something will be left over. So let's see. So this thing here was zero, as I said. So that's yes, that's still zero. Good. And PR, for PR, we insert this equation here now. So that's minus dH by dr plus fr. And here, for that guy, we use that equation. So that's just r dot. And yeah, for L dot, L dot is zero plus this radiation reaction force. So it's F phi. And this guy is just phi due to this equation. Phi dot, yes. Thanks. Good. So that's it. Now let's see. So this term is cancelled by this one here, right? And this goes away anyway. So what we have left over is this term with the radiation reaction force in R direction, and this term here with the radiation reaction force in phi direction. So it's R dot times FR plus phi dot times F phi. So we see that we have now angular momentum loss and also energy loss. Yeah, but the question now is how can we choose these two forces in some consistent way such that basically the post-Newtonian results that you can compute for these two quantities. Yeah. So, yeah, so what do we do? Since we have computed these two losses, we can again do a balance, right? We do an energy and angular balance. which is now which is quite often done in these kind of situations. Yeah, it's also done when you, for instance, compute the decay of the orbit and how the eccentricity changes. You do a very similar thing. Write down the energy and angular momentum in terms of eccentricity and semi-major axis. Do an energy balance, and then you find that the orbit shrinks and also the eccentricity shrinks. Yeah, and it's a classical computation by Peters and Matthews. And you also find that the eccentricity shrinks faster than the semi-major axis, and that basically leads to the fact that you usually end up with an almost circular orbit. So that's one case where you also use this kind of balance for energy and angular momentum. And also in the first lecture, when you just construct in spiral only waveforms from post-Newtonian results, you also balance this binding energy with the luminosity, so with the energy loss, and you get this evolution of the phase and everything, right? So that I briefly recapitulated in the first lecture. So that's really often the important principle that you use in order to get the dissipation into the game. It's you compute energy and angular momentum loss from a local dynamics, and then you balance that to the fluxes at infinity. Okay. So let's do that. We now do an energy and angular momentum balance. Now here I have to mention some caveat of that, namely that this balance only holds on average and not instantaneously at a given time. So it only holds on average and not instantaneously. The reason is basically that you maybe have some near zone where the two bodies orbit each other. And in that near zone, you compute this E dot and L dot, but the fluxes are really measured very far away at infinity, right? So here's where you measure the energy and angular momentum fluxes. So it's not really guaranteed that at a fixed given time, the two have to balance. They only have to balance on average, right? There's some energy that's somehow maybe lost in the zone between the orbit and the radiation zone far away. Maybe it doesn't quite know how to get to infinity, or maybe part of that goes back into the near zone. Who knows? All you know is that on average, energy and angular momentum cannot be destroyed. Yeah, so that's a bit of a subtlety here, and that leads to the so-called shock terms in the balance law. And they are called like that because they were first discovered actually in classical electrodynamics. So it's also not a nonlinear effect. It's also there in electrodynamics, and that was shown by Schott some long time ago. Okay, but yeah, they will not be such a big deal. You just have to be aware of that. So now let's balance things. So we have the E dot, and we have the Schott terms, and we have the energy flux at infinity, and we have a similar equation for the angular momentum loss. Yeah. Like this, and these things have to balance to have energy and conservation. In a previous lecture, we called this energy flux at infinity the luminosity L, right? But since here we have two different types of fluxes, I'll denote it like this for now. And so just to make it clear, these two guys are the fluxes at infinity. Yeah. Not exactly, because this would be a nonlinear effect. So it's a little more than that. It's also just that the energy that goes out here is not instantaneously visible at infinity. It's a bit. Yeah. Because this is an equation that holds at any instant in time. But at a fixed instant in time, when the energy goes out here, it's not immediately at infinity, right? So, it first has to somehow, the waves have to peel off from the source and then somehow enter the wave zone. And that process is, I don't know, it's not easy to capture in an analytic way, right? When you look at a textbook in electrodynamics, it's easy to do an approximation at the source, then you have a near field solution of the field, and it's easy to look at the solution far away in a wave zone. But what happens in between, it's a bit difficult to interpret or to write down analytically, but it's kind of separated also, right? So the energy needs some time to propagate through that zone. And what exactly happens there is, I don't know how to interpret that. It's just that when you look at the energy balance at a fixed time, you have to take that into account. If you would average these equations, then you would get rid of that. And for circular orbits, for example, this wouldn't matter because circular orbits look the same all through, so you can, you don't have to average explicitly. But if you have an eccentric orbit, you would either have to average the thing or you have to include the short terms. To write it down a bit more explicitly, so these short terms, they average to zero. So, you don't have a violation of energy or angular momentum conservation on average. It's not due to the nonlinearities of its theory. It's more due to the fact that E and L are basically describing what happens in the near zone, in the near field part, and the fluxes describe what happens very far away. But there's some region in between where basically the waves peel off from the source, and that's difficult to describe analytically, and that's basically taking that into account. So to say, the energy that's in that weird region where you don't know what's happening. But it doesn't have anything to do with nonlinearities or with backscattering. That's going on top of that in GR. But this effect with short terms is also there in classical electrodynamics, which is completely linear. Yeah, and that's what Schott was basically, what he found out. Okay. So now let's combine the things. So we have this formula for L dot, this formula for E dot, and these two balance equations. We can put that all together. And then we have R dot times the radiation reaction force in R direction plus phi dot and the radiation reaction force in phi direction plus the shot term. And this has to balance the energy flux at infinity. And then we have a similar term for the angular momentum balance. Like this. Now, the thing is, what you have to do is, you can take post-Newtonian expressions for these fluxes, and all you have to do is to find one consistent solution for the forces and these shot terms. That's the game, and there are many different choices. But once you construct one, you have one consistent set, so to say, or you have one consistent solution for the radiation reaction forces. And the reason why you have different choices for that is, again, the gauge freedom of general relativity. It's connected to that. Now, actually, I will do a bit of a shortcut now, and I will just refer you to the paper for these forces and where that solution is worked out. And what we will do from now on is, again, go to a quasi-circular case, which is a bit simpler. So the general solution, or one general and nice solution for the radiation reaction forces, and also for the shot terms, given the fluxes coming from post-Newtonian theory, you can find that in by Bini and Damour from 2012. What we will do here from now on is, again, assume to be on quasi-circular orbits. Quasi-circular and spiral. And basically, all currently used EUB models are doing it that way. So, I mean, there's not yet an effective one-body model that's valid for eccentric orbits, which is implemented in such a way that it's used for the data analysis. So, that would be a good thing to do, right? To take these more generic expressions and actually build a waveform model based on that or something similar. But what I will show you now is what's usually used in the LIGO analysis, and it's much simpler. Okay, so what we do is essentially the following. So if you imagine now you have a basically circular orbit, and you introduce, so maybe the body is moving in that direction, and you are breaking it with a phi force or with an FR force, then I mean you see that you only really need one of them, right? Because all you need to do is make the orbit shrink, and whether you make it slow, starts to fall in, or whether you really push it towards lower radii, it's basically the same effect, right? On a circular orbit, you only need one of these forces. And so what we do then is we drop the FR because I mean, you see here, if you set Fi to zero, you cannot satisfy the angular momentum balance anymore, right? If you make this this zero, well, and I should say for circular orbits, you can also ignore the shot terms, then basically you cannot balance the angular momentum flux. But if you drop Fr, then this thing just goes away, and you still have here Fi to balance both the energy and the angular momentum at the same time. Yeah, so this is a choice that we can make for us in order to simplify things. And since we are on a circular orbit, all the averaging or all the shot terms and URL. So let's also drop this L dot shot. Good. So now, that simplifies things quite a bit. Yeah. Sorry, can you say that again? Yeah, so I mean, it would be useful to drop either one of them, right? But if you drop Fi, then basically this goes away and you cannot satisfy the angular momentum balance anymore. So you cannot do that. This is inconsistent. So you can, if you want to drop either of them, you can only drop Fr. That's the point. Yeah. Okay. So when this is done, we have what? Okay, wait. Let's first write down these equations again. So we have phi dot f phi plus energy flux equals to zero, and we have f phi plus the angular momentum flux equals to zero. So that means that we can now write the remaining radiation reaction force in the phi direction in the following way. It's basically minus the angular momentum flux. And if we look at that equation, it also has to be equal to this here, right? So that's coming from here. And now I'm going back to the notation from the first lecture. So I'm now again calling the energy flux the luminosity, the gravitation wave luminosity. So that would be divided by omega. And remember, post-Newtonian theory gives you L of x, where x is, where is x? X was m omega to the 2/3, I believe. Right? So all of this is now a function of omega, or equivalently of this x parameter. Yep. Good, good. But now again, similar to the Hamiltonian, in principle, you should try to resum this in a reasonable way, because usually a Taylor expansion does not work very well in this kind of context for post-Newtonian results, at least when you go further and further into the strong field regime. So, yeah, the thing is, this can be obtained from the post-Newtonian theory. But we would like to resum that somehow. Well, how to do that exactly? Well, that's a difficult question, and there's no clear answer for that. But of course, you can maybe find something that makes sense and then compare to numerical relativity. And if it works, then it works. I'll just tell you basically now what is done. And try to motivate some bits of it, but again, you cannot completely motivate or derive some way to resum a Taylor series that you don't know completely, right? So there's some kind of guesswork involved, but in the end, the proof, if you want, comes from the fact that you compare the waveform in the end to numerical relativity, and if it matches to the accuracy that you want to have, then the model is good, yeah? That's the spirit. What we do now is we don't directly resum the energy loss, but we resum the gravitational wave modes, because we also need them, right? We also want to know how does a gravitational wave look like. So we actually obtain some nice version for the gravitational wave modes. And if we have the gravitational wave at infinity, of course, we can also compute the energy that's contained in them. So that's what we do. We also need the gravitational wave modes. So the plus and cross polarization, and usually you write them together in this way as a complex wave. And this you decompose then into spin-weighted spherical harmonics, like this. And these guys you also get from post-Newtonian calculations, basically. In the first lecture, I've shown you a bit of that, basically just the leading L equal to part, right? But there's a lot more. you look at these guys and you find a nice resummation for these modes. And from the modes, then basically you can get the luminosity, because it's kind of an integral surface over the, and what enters there are the time derivatives of both polarizations. You can see when you insert this kind of equation, you can somehow relate the energy loss to the modes directly. Right? So if you have the modes, then basically you can directly easily compute the energy loss. The modes are kind of like the amplitudes, and the amplitude square gives you the energy in the gravitational wave, essentially. Okay. So the algorithm, so to say, is now we find a resummation that's good for these gravitational wave modes. Then from there, we can get the luminosity. And from the luminosity, we get the radiation reaction force. And that goes into the equations of motion, and then we can further evolve the system. Yeah. So it's a, in the end, it's a big system of equations, right? You have some equations which tell you how the motion looks like. Then from the motion, basically, you get how the gravitational wave looks like. And that, in turn, gives you the one of the forces that goes into the equations of motion. So from here, we get the radiation reaction force. So that's how it's done. And now to the modes. So, how do you actually resum the modes? That's rather simple compared to the resummation of the potentials. Namely, that we are just factorizing the mode into different factors, into different blocks, which have a specific meaning, so to say. That's all. So it's not a huge resummation of any kind. It's just like writing a thing into factors that somehow make sense physically, somehow. Yeah. So that's the very, very basic resummation factor. So let's approach this step by step. First thing that is done is that one factors out the leading term or the Newtonian term. Yeah. So it's not really Newtonian because in Newton's theory you don't have any gravitational waves, but it's often called Newtonian because it's leading term and that. So in the post-Newtonian expansion, you call, anyway, you call this the Newtonian term, or better is maybe the, to call it the leading order. Okay, so you factor all that, and then whatever remains, let's call it HLM hat for now. And all of that, of course, is a function only of x, since we work with circular orbits. So, at least for now. Good. So that's one basic way of resumming that thing. But now we also decompose the remaining part into some blocks with some physical meaning. So that H hat LM is again factorized. into the following form. Namely, you have a term which is called the effective source. And you have a term related to logarithms or tail effects, which is called TLM. And well, define all of these later. Then a term which is kind of all the rest. And a term that's related to some radius that appears in the calculation at some point. So, but again, the justification to split these things is basically justification plainly is so far it works quite well. Namely, that when you compare it to numerical relativity, this seems to be a good way of resumming the post-Newtonian modes to make them behave better in the strong field regime. But there's still some sense to it. So this term, for example, is inspired by the fact that when you do the computation of the modes, what you have in the result initially is something like a radial position to the power of L. Of course, that depends on coordinates, so this would be usually in harmonic coordinates. And then it becomes a lot more complicated because you go to the variable x, and the transformation from R to x is quite complicated. And this resummation basically takes it into account by saying, okay, let's not expand this piece. Let's keep it together, because it was coming from a very simple structure initially in the calculation, and then just because you transform to a different variable, it becomes complicated and it's many more terms. Well, that doesn't mean one actually has to expand everything and make that explicitly very, very complicated, but you keep that together, so to say. This next term also has an even nicer interpretation. That's called the effective source. That term is basically coming from the fact that the gravitational wave that goes out is propagating in a space-time that's not flat, but that's curved by the binary itself. So that's curved by the total mass and angular momentum of the binary system in particular. So this effective source term, S effective, corresponds to the fact that gravitational waves propagate in the field of the binary. So it represents basically the gravitational field that binary is sourcing. And it takes on two different values depending on whether the mode is even or odd. So for the even modes, which are, so to say, the modes more related to the mass density, for them, you use the effective Hamiltonian divided by mu. And for the other one, you use basically the angular momentum divided by the Newtonian value of the angular momentum as a function of x. So that's for the odd parts of the modes. So, I mean, people tried also some different versions of that, but this was working well. So that's what people stick with since then. And yeah, what are we missing? This T term and this term with the e to the I delta Lm. So let's see what that is. Well, you see that this business with the modes and the radiation reaction is not as nice as the Hamiltonian somehow. So maybe from a physical point of view, it's still improvable, and one should better understand how to treat that and how to build good formulas for the modes in a strong field regime. But I mean, these things work well for now, but it's not that nice. It's a little bit ugly. Okay. Anyway. Now, the final physical bit, so to say, is this T here, which comes from resumming the leading logarithms. So you can actually do a post-Newtonian, or you can do a computation to get all these leading logarithms and then sum them up in a simple way, which, well, it's given by a gamma function of L plus 1 minus 2i k, and that k basically is related to the ADM mass, which here is represented by the real Hamiltonian. So that's supposed to represent the ADM mass, which plays a very important role in how these logarithms are generated, because they often come from the backscatter of the gravitational waves on the potential of a binary. And that potential is dominated by the ADM mass, which here corresponds to the real Hamiltonian. And then there's another gamma function of L plus 1 here. Then you have e to the pi k and e to the 2i k times logarithm of 2k and some scale parameter R naught. Right, so this k here has dimension. So when you do logarithms, you always have some kind of arbitrary scale in them. And the choice that is made for this R naught is 2m divided by the square root of the Euler number. Okay, so that's basically the formulas that are used for the gravitational wave modes. And the last bit, it's literally the rest. So everything that's not covered by what I've shown you, but you still need something more in order to reproduce the post-Newtonian results for the modes. All of that is going into a rest term, if you want, which is then this e to the I delta Lm. Okay. Now that was not as nice as the Hamiltonian already, but now it even gets a little worse, because in the end this was just for circular orbits, and when you come to the end of the in-spiral, that approximation is not good anymore. So you would also expect some corrections to the gravitational wave modes when the orbital motion is not exactly circular anymore, right? So the big but is that the circular approximation PR approximately zero. That's not good during the late in spiral. So what one does then is to introduce so-called non-quasi-circular parameters or non-quasi-circular corrections to the gravitational wave modes. Okay, so one introduces non-quasi-circular or NQC corrections. That some functions F, Lm, NQC, plus I should also mention some other tweaks here and there. I will mention one of them in a minute. Yeah? Yeah, that's a choice, I think. But that's not constant. Yeah. So usually, what you want to when you have these kinds of logarithms, you usually want to pick a scale that makes a logarithm small, right? And since we want to describe a gravitational wave also in particular close to the end of the spiral, it makes sense to set it to 2m, which is more or less the horizon size of a finite black hole. It's the biggest. It's more like a smallest here, right? Yeah. Or is it big? Yeah. 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 Yep. Okay. So these guys, what you do to them, with them, is basically you multiply that function simply on top of these modes. So it's again a factorized form. You just have some particular function which depends on PR. So when PR is not zero, these Fs will be unequal from one slightly. We're not going into much detail on how they look like. I mean, there's also not much to it as far as I understand it. It's just you make some ansatz for them with some coefficients, and these are the remaining calibration parameters that you have. That's the main point I wanted to make. So you make some ansatz with some parameters, and this again gets somehow matched to a numerical relativity. And yeah, recall that there were also other parameters already that I mentioned in the very beginning of the lecture, namely that also there were some parameters in the EUB potentials. The EUB potentials also have matching parameters. Overall, these are not that many parameters, so it's quite okay. But still, you don't want to tune them by hand. I mean, once you have more than two parameters or so, you don't really want to play with all the possible values to find the best match. And also, you're not just matching maybe one numerical relativity waveform, but many. So what is often done, for example, in our group now, is that the matching to numerical relativity is done in a similar way as a parameter estimation problem. Right? So you could take the numerical relativity waveforms as the real waveforms, and then you have a parameterized effective one-body waveform, and you try to find the parameters which best match. So you do a parameter estimation of the EOB calibration parameters when you compare to numerical relativity. And there are methods for that, which work very well and which are also used for the gravitational wave data analysis. And they work on high-dimensional parameter spaces and so on. And maybe Ricardo Sturani told you a little bit about that, right? In the first week, maybe. Okay. So then, at this point, what we have constructed now is the following. We have taken as much analytical knowledge and as much physical intuition as we could, packed it into this waveform model for the in-spiral, and then we did some little more ugly things, introduced some parameters such that we can match the very highly dynamical strong field regime, so it matches with numerical simulations. And what we have at this point is then basically, so status is we have a waveform model for the in-spiral and the plunge. Okay, so we have Hamilton's equations, and they are really, in principle, you can apply them until the two bodies collide, until the two black holes collide. So it's the in-spiral, this small phase, slow phase, where the two objects orbit and slowly move towards each other. Then in the end, there's a small rapid plunge, and at the end of the plunge, the two bodies would merge. And that's the part that we have to add now. So we have in-spiral plunge. Now the question is, what about the merger, and in particular, the ring down? So everything that happens after the merger. So that's now the next thing. And once we have that, we have a complete waveform. So we miss the ring down. And one way to describe that, ring down, is by perturbing a black hole. So you can see the modeling of that last phase basically in a backwards way almost. So you think of the final object, which is just a black hole sitting there, no dynamics. And you think of where it came from, and it has to come from a perturbed black hole. So basically, you are now perturbing that final state and somehow try to match it to the waveform that you have when the two bodies start to merge. Right? So for the last phase, for the ring down, what you do is you perturb the final black hole. I will just tell you a little bit about that, because yesterday in the talks we have already heard a lot about black hole perturbations. So I just give you a quick idea. So in what you have is you have a decomposition of a metric into some background and some small perturbation. So this should be small, and here I take this to be just a Schwarzschild. Oops. Schwarzschild geometry, non-rotating black hole. And what you get then is you get a master equation for these perturbations, right? So you have to choose a gauge for this part. And then it turns out that you can basically define master functions and master equations from which you can get the full perturbation in that gauge. And that equation looks pretty, pretty simple. So it's something like d squared dr star minus some potential applied to that master function equals zero. So it's something like a wave equation. And this here basically is this master function. This R is the so-called tortoise coordinate. Sorry, the R star thing. And here we could define it by A divided by square root of D bar. So that's using the notation of the EUB potentials. But remember that in Schwarzschild, it's equal to 1 minus 2 m over r, and d bar is equal to 1. You can also define this tortoise coordinates in EUB, basically by using the full EUB potentials for a and d bar. Now I'm almost at the end of what I wanted to say here. Let me just sketch how this potential looks like. So kind of you have a scattering problem at this potential, the Reggie Wheeler potential. And it looks somehow like this, more or less. What's useful to note is that R basically goes from the horizon to M to infinity. But if you apply this mapping here, then you see that R star goes from minus infinity to plus infinity, right? So the horizon is at minus infinity here, and the real asymptotic infinity is over there. So it's now really more something like a scattering problem that you have. The black hole perturbations propagate here, and this is the potential, basically. Otherwise, it's similar to a Schrödinger equation and to scattering. Okay. So the last remark that I wanted to make here is I wanted to mention one of these tweaks that I alluded to over here, and that is that in practice what is also done is that the EUB is actually written in terms of a PR star. So what one uses in practice is actually not the radial momentum as we've seen so far, but one uses basically a radial momentum that's conjugate to the tortoise coordinate. So at some point in the past, the people figured out that then you get better agreement for small mass ratios for the gravitational waves. So that's one of the tweaks that's also in the model. Okay, so that's a radiation reaction and the spiral plunge. Next time, I hope it will be a bit nicer again, and I would try to explain more in physical terms of how the ring down can be understood and constructed. I think it will be a little less technical and a bit more physical again. So thanks and see you. Do you have yeah? Yeah, so for Kerr black holes, or for generally for spinning black holes, there are two approaches currently, or maybe depends how you count, maybe even more. So the issue is not completely settled, but what is there definitely is you have a map again from some test body case to the real case. So let's say here you have the real binary. Yeah, and you want to map that to some effective problem. Then one case would be that you have a point mass orbiting in that spacetime. So you have a spin on this guy, but no spin on this guy. Right, so these two black holes are now maybe spinning. They have a spin vector, an angular momentum vector. So that's one thing that you can do. Or you could also try to map that to a bit more complicated situation where we have a Kerr black hole and not a test mass, but a test spinning body described by the so-called Matheson, Papapetro, Dixon equations. So you can also have a spin on that guy. That leads to a much more complicated Hamiltonian. And then again, you try to input all the post-Newtonian information that you have for spin effects coming from post-Newtonian theory, which are also known up to the fourth post-Newtonian order. And then again, in the mode, yeah. The competitive, no. I mean, you do these kind of mappings to the test body cases, and then similar to what we had for non-spinning black holes, you deform the potentials in the Hamiltonian to include post-Newtonian information. Yeah. But yeah, you also recover some test body motion in the Kerr spacetime, exactly for the effective Hamiltonian. And yeah, there's also work for tidal effects for neutron stars. So either the two or one of them could also be a neutron star. Okay. More questions? So, okay, then let's have coffee. And when should we be back? At 11:45, right? Yeah. Good. See you. Yeah. Yeah.